There are four reflex pathways in the eye: the light reflex, the accommodation reflex, the corneal reflex, and the conjunctival reflex. Today in this video, we are going to talk about the light and the accommodation reflexes and their anomalies because they have some similarities in their pathways. The light reflex entails constriction of the pupil when the light hits the eye. The purpose of this reflex is to prevent excessive amounts of light from entering the eye, as large amounts of light is detrimental to the retina. There are two components of the light reflex, the direct and the indirect. In the direct reflex, the pupil of the same eye constricts, whereas in the indirect light reflex, the pupil on the opposite side constricts. Observe my eye as a beam of light hits it. The light reflex starts with the light hitting the eye and the impulses being conducted to the optic chiasma through the optic nerve. From here, fibers of the optic tract carry impulses to the pretectal nucleus in the midbrain. The Edinger-Westphal nucleus of both sides receives impulses from the pretectal nucleus. Preganglionic fibers from the Edinger-Westphal nucleus relay in the ciliary ganglion, from where postganglionic fibers lead to the sphincter pupillae muscle and cause constriction of the pupil. Bilateral innervation at the Edinger-Westphal nucleus is responsible for the indirect or the consensual light reflex. Now, let's talk about the accommodation reflex. The accommodation reflex consists of constriction of the pupils, convergence of the eyeballs, and increase in the curvature of the anterior surface of the lens when the eye needs to focus on a near object. Observe the change when an object is held near the camera lens. This refocusing of the lens occurs in less than 1 second in the eye. The accommodation reflex is pretty similar to the light reflex. It starts off passing through the optic nerve, passes through the optic chiasma and the optic tract to reach the lateral geniculate body. From the lateral geniculate body, fibers pass to the visual cortex. Fibers from the visual cortex lead to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. From the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, fibers follow the same pathway as the light reflex. Understand that the pretectal nucleus is not a part of the accommodation reflex. We will explain the clinical significance of this fact when we talk about the anomalies of these pathways. So now that we've seen the two pathways in detail, we need to understand the various things that can go wrong with these pathways. There are three lesions of importance that we need to know and distinguish. First is the Marcus Gunn pupil. This defect is also known as the relative afferent pupillary defect. Essentially, the lesion in this condition is in between the retina and the optic chiasma, and the afferent impulses, or the impulses going away from the eye, are affected. This defect can be diagnosed by the swinging flashlight test. Basically, a flashlight is swung from the affected eye to the unaffected eye. When the light is shown on the affected eye, no change is observed or minimal constriction is observed in both the eyes. Recall that the fibers carrying impulses away from the eye are affected. When the light is swung over to the unaffected eye, a constriction of both pupils is observed. Remember that the efferent fibers, or the fibers coming to the eye, are still intact. So when the light is shown back on the affected eye, the pupil will be dilating. This phenomenon is commonly seen in optic neuritis, which is an inflammation of the optic nerve. Next is the Argyll Roberts pupil. These pupils react to accommodation and not to light reflex. They are small, irregular pupils and show some more constriction when the eyes try to accommodate to near objects. Remember that the light reflex passes through the pretectal nucleus, whereas the accommodation reflex does not involve the pretectal nucleus. Argyll Roberts pupil is caused by lesions around the pretectal nucleus. It is most commonly seen in diabetes and in neurosyphilis, hence the nickname prostitute's pupil. Next, we have the Holmes Adie pupil. The basic problem in Holmes Adie pupil is that the postganglionic parasympathetic fibers from the ciliary ganglion are affected, either by infection or inflammation. Similar to Argyll Robertson's pupil, the pupils in Holmes Adie syndrome respond to accommodation and not to the light reflex, the so-called light near dissociation. The pupil is tonically dilated, as opposed to Argyll Roberts' pupil. There may also be associated generalized areflexia and autonomic dysfunction. The Argyll Roberts' pupil and the Holmes Adie pupil can be distinguished clinically by the response to accommodation. In an Argyll Roberts' pupil, the response to accommodation is swift and immediate, and all components of accommodation are present. In Holmes Adie pupil, the response to accommodation is slow and prolonged, and convergence of the eyeball may not be prominent due to weakness of the muscles involved. Thank you for watching the video. If you have any questions, please reach out to us in the comment section below.